Hello guys, welcome back. So we'll be learning today about the abdomen layers, its muscles and the retroperitoneal organs. Okay, so I've drawn a very simplified version diagram. You have to draw this. Okay, and this diagram will be used for your better understanding. Okay, you have to draw the simplified version. This diagram is only for your better understanding. So first, starting with the abdomen layers. For layers, you must remember them in a sequence. Okay, because they are situated one after the another. So we'll be starting from the very outside layer, which is skin. So abdomen. So starting first with the skin, if you remove the skin, you can see something called as superficial fascia. What is superficial fascia? Now it is two layered. Okay, so you must know both the layers name. One is Camper's fascia and another is Carpa's fascia. For Camper's fascia, write down, it is soft and spongy fat. So the superficial fascia type, that is Camper's fascia, it consists of spongy fat and is soft. The Scarpa's fascia, it is membranous. Okay. The third layer is external oblique. It's also a muscle. The fourth is, if you remove the external oblique, you can see the internal oblique. They are situated obliquely like this. So that's why it was given the term oblique. The fifth is transverse abdominis. It is also muscle. So layers and muscles we are doing together. The sixth is transversalis fascia. So how many fascia have we done till now? Two fascias. And that's all you have to remember regarding the fascia. And lastly, the peritoneum. Okay. In the next video, we'll be doing about the peritoneum folds. The lesser omentum and the greater omentum. At that time, I'll tell you about the peritoneum in detail. So don't worry. Now you know all these seven layers, right? That is skin, superficial fascia, external oblique, internal oblique, transverse abdominis, transversalis fascia, peritoneum. Among these, three are muscles. This one, these three are muscles of the abdomen. Okay? And there is something called as rectus abdominis. Write down. It is also the muscle of our abdomen. So for layers, you have to remember all these seven in a sequence, and then separately you must remember the rectus abdominis muscle. Okay. This rectus abdominis muscle, it has tendinous insertions. Write down. It has tendinous insertions. There are two rectus abdominis muscle. How many? Two. Suppose this is one rectus abdominis muscle and this is another rectus abdominis muscle. It is separated by a line, and that line is called as linea alba. It is present in the midline, okay, and it is also visible in the humans. Not exactly visible, but if you look at the middle of your abdomen, you could almost see a line in between, okay, that is linea alba. This rectus abdominis, as I said to you, it has this tendinous insertions. And this tendinous insertions, if a person has this rectus abdominis well developed, then it gives you abs. What it will give you? Six pack abs. So the people who are working out for making abs, they are actually working out on their which muscle? Rectus abdominis muscle. We'll be looking at through a picture just in few minutes. But before that, there are a few extra points that you should know. So write down, this internal oblique and transverse abdominis muscle together forms a conjoint tendon. Together forms conjoint tendon. That's all you have to remember for these two muscles. And one more thing, there is something called as rectus sheath. Very important. Sheath is what? Sheath is a covering, right? So rectus sheath, it is formed by, first of all, let's write that. It is formed by three muscles. And that is external oblique plus half internal oblique. You have transverse abdominis and the rest half of the internal oblique. So how many muscles? Internal oblique is divided into two. Half it will move on with the external oblique and half goes with the transverse abdominis. So total three muscles will together form this rectus sheath. Now this external oblique plus internal half internal oblique. They form the anterior wall of the rectus sheath, or you can say they form the anterior rectus sheath. This transverse abdominis and half of the internal oblique, they form the posterior rectus sheath. Now, what does this rectus sheath encloses? So, write down, this rectus sheath, it encloses two muscles. One muscle, so you should know already. What should it be? Rectus abdominis, your six-pack abs muscle, plus there is a muscle called as pyramidalis. Okay, these two together forms will be present in the rectus sheath. Okay, now rectus sheath has few things. It contains few things. So write down contents, or you can write rectus sheath have. It contains the muscle we've already done. It contains rectus abdominis and pyramidalis. Now let's know about the vessels. Superior epigastric vessels. Second is inferior epigastric muscle. Inferior epigastric. Second is inferior epigastric vessels. Third is lower six thoracic nerves. Lower six thoracic spinal nerves. Okay, guys. And lastly, the tendinous insertions you can write. Or you can write only tendons. Okay. Among these, what do you have to remember extra? The superior epigastric vessel, it is branch of musculophrenic artery. What it is a branch of? Musculophrenic artery. Now this musculophrenic artery, it is the branch of internal thoracic artery. You remember this internal thoracic artery, right? This internal thoracic artery, you can write down. It is branch of second division of subclavian artery. We have done this when we were doing the arteries of the upper limb. Okay. So this internal thoracic artery, which is also called as mammary artery, right? So it is branch of second division of which artery? Subclavian artery. Now, one more extra point regarding the inferior epigastric vessel, write down. It is branch of external iliac artery. Now, we have done external iliac artery also, right? External iliac artery was the branch coming from the common iliac artery. And how was common iliac artery formed? It was formed by the, it is the continuation of the abdominal aorta. So, that's all you have to remember regarding the layers, regarding the rectus abdominis muscle, regarding the rectus sheath. Now, let's look at the diagram. First, let's look at this diagram, then we'll move on with the simplified version and revise once again. So, you have the skin on the very outermost layer. Then you have this yellow color, which you see, this is superficial fascia divided into two, the camper's fascia and the scarpa's fascia. Then, on the lateral side, you can see the external oblique towards the very outer side. Then you have internal oblique, and behind that, you will have this transverse abdominis muscle. All three muscles of our abdomen. Rectus abdominis, it is situated in the middle, as you can see. Now, what is this view? If you are getting confused, then this view is the top view. Okay, you have cut the body in from between, and you're looking at from the top. So this is how it will look: the outermost skin, superficial fascia, and between you will find this rectus abdominis muscle, and laterally external oblique, internal oblique, transverse abdominis. Now you can see that they are having this aponeurosis, which are going towards the medial side of the body, right? This white color aponeurosis. Okay. Now, one more thing. I told you that there is something called as rectus sheath. So you can see this white color sheath, right? Not exactly this white color sheath, but if I draw it like this, so this becomes your rectus sheath. Now this rectus sheath, you can see that it is formed by external oblique, half internal oblique. This is the anterior wall of the rectus sheath, and this is the posterior wall of the rectus sheath. So anterior is formed by external oblique and half of the internal oblique. The posterior wall will be formed by the transverse abdominis and internal oblique. You have this transversalis fascia. This transversalis fascia on the very posterior side, and then you have this peritoneum, and behind this peritoneum will be all your small intestine, your stomach, and all other organs. Okay, now let's look at the simplified diagram. You have to draw this. So this is the skin, what it is, the outermost skin. This is the anterior region, and this is posterior region. Okay, you're looking from the top once again. Then you have the superficial fascia divided into two. And laterally, you can see you have this external oblique. You have internal oblique, and transverse abdominis. In between, you have this rectus abdominis muscle, right? And posterior side you have this transversalis fascia and this green is your peritoneum. Okay, I have drawn here, right? You can see that this is the external oblique and half of the internal oblique. They together will form the anterior wall of the rectus sheath. So this gray which I have drawn surrounding the rectus abdominis, this is the rectus sheath. Okay, and posteriorly you can see half of the internal oblique and transverse abdominis are forming the posterior wall. Okay, so this is the posterior wall, and then you have peritoneum, then further you will have all the organs. I hope this diagram is very easy to draw and easy to remember. Okay, then this is the rectus abdominis muscle, your six pack abs muscle. You can see in between you have this linea alba. Okay, linea alba, and then on either side you will have this rectus abdominis muscle, and you have this tendinous insertions. Okay, these divisions which you're seeing, those are actually the tendinous insertions. Now, this tendinous insertions and this rectus abdominis, if it is well developed, people get abs in their body. Okay, and downwardly, this rectus abdominis meets with the pyramidalis muscle. This is the pyramidalis muscle. So, pyramidalis muscle and rectus abdominis together will be enclosed into a sheath, which is called as rectus sheath. So, I hope this is clear. Contents, you should remember what and all will be present over here. Now, let's do the new topic, that is the retroperitoneal organs. You just have to remember the name of the organs. Okay, and nothing else. So write down the mnemonic for it. Sad pucker. That is sad pucker. So here S stands for, write down, S stands for suprarenal gland. What it is? Suprarenal gland. What is the other name of suprarenal? Adrenal gland. We did it in the kidney video also. Right? Then A stands for aorta and inferior vena cava. Okay. D stands for duodenum. D stands for duodenum. P stands for pancreas. The pancreas is divided into parts. So this pancreas except tail. So tail becomes your intraperitoneal organ. Tail of the pancreas comes under the intraperitoneal side. Okay. Intraperitoneal is, means they will be covered with the peritoneum. U stands for ureter. Crock question regarding pancreas and ureter. So you must remember these and the rest also, because crock is developing. So they might ask you different organs this time. C stands for colon. Now which colon? We have done four colons. The ascending colon, the transverse colon, the descending colon, the sigmoid colon. So here which colon is the ascending and descending colon? Sigmoid colon always goes along with the descending colon, so you don't have to write it. You just have to remember then that here I have not written transverse colon because it is the part of the intraperitoneal organ. K is for kidney. Okay, we did it in the previous video itself. That time I told you that kidney is a retroperitoneal organ. So now you know more organs which are retroperitoneal along with kidney. E stands for esophagus and R stands for rectum. Okay, so I hope now this retroperitoneal organs are clear. If you remember the sad pucker organs, then rest, whatever organ you get, apart from these, they all are intraperitoneal organs. So please remember this. They surely give one question regarding this in crock exam. So please, you have to remember everything of this video. Okay, so that's all. Thank you.